Getting ready for Kennedy. I'm Brian Moore, and this is Focus NNS. We're here in Boston, Massachusetts at the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum, the namesake of CVN 79. We're gearing up for some major milestones for the Kennedy, and we'll tell you more about that and take you inside the museum. Plus, the newest Virginia-class submarine celebrates a milestone, and science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, better known as STEM, and it's the focus of our newest offices at Brooks Crossing. Those stories and more are coming up, but first on deck, John F. Kennedy was the 35th President of the United States and the namesake of the aircraft carrier CV-67. Now he's the namesake of the latest aircraft carrier in the Gerald R. Ford class of carrier, CVN-79. CVN-79 is just a few months away from a major milestone. The superlifts are done, the island has landed, and plans for the christening are well underway. The John F. Kennedy, the second aircraft carrier in the Ford class, will soon be front and center as the ship sponsor, Caroline Kennedy, christens the ship named for her father. The event is scheduled for December 7th in the North Yard at Dry Dock 12. Shipbuilders and their families will be invited, so stay tuned for more information about the event. So exciting times are ahead for the Kennedy, and a little later we'll take you inside the museum for more. There's also exciting times going on for the Virginia-class submarine program as Delaware SSN 791 returns from successful sea trials. Aaron Pritchett with our communications division has the story.
It's a challenging process from concept and design to the laying of the keel all the way up to delivery. But through it all, it's the immense sense of pride that is the driving force that has helped the best shipbuilders in the world reach the finish line and put all that hard work to the ultimate test with sea trials, as Delaware SSN 791 recently took to the open waters of the Atlantic Ocean for the very first time.
We get to build the most technologically advanced submarines in the world. We're a part of that. How many people get to do that?
Yeah, it's extremely prideful to know that the hard work that we do day in and day out, weekends, weeknights, that we're here countless hours, can go to defend our country and do a great job out there.
There's so much hard work and effort goes into it that people don't see, but we have the best mechanics in the world right here working on these, and it's just, you know, really it gives you a good sense of feeling right here to see all these people coming together and making this ship what it is today.
It's rewarding because you know that you were a part of something that's bigger than you, you know? And what that ship means is defending the country, defending America, my family, your family. It's just awesome.
We know that we have to deliver the best product possible. So when they take that to sea, because they're the heart of that submarine. You know, we might be the backbone, but they're the heart. And you know, they're out there doing an impossible job. They're leaving families behind for months at a time. So yeah, we're gonna make daggone sure that when they go to sea, they're gonna be taking care of us and we've taken care of them.
A lot of people don't get this opportunity to actually see this, you know, behind the scenes, like I like to call it. And it's awesome. It's a sense of pride.
Definitely quite a sight to see Delaware SSN 791 in the water and from the air. And a great reminder that behind every great submarine and or aircraft carrier that we build are the talented men and women of Newport News Shipbuilding who bring them to life. For Focus NNS, I'm Aaron Pritchett. Back to you, Brian.
All right, thanks so much, Aaron, and congratulations to the Virginia-class submarine program. Now, let's take a look at some other news from around the yard. Newport News Shipbuilding is proud to honor 231 shipbuilders during the 2019 Model of Excellence Award Ceremony. The event was held on September 20th and recognizes individuals and teams for their performance and accomplishments in categories that align with the NNS forward strategy.
You don't go out expecting any kind of recognition for what you do because this is your job, but it's always nice to get something and know that people are actually paying attention and noticing what you're doing and how much you actually overcome and what you did to get that job done.
Newport News Shipbuilding President Jennifer Boykin told the winners they are the best of the best and that she is proud to recognize their hard work, innovation, commitment, and achievement. The Kennedy Library is all about history, and back in Newport News, the Apprentice School is celebrating some history of its own. A historical highway marker was unveiled over the summer and is now in place on Washington Avenue in front of the school. They have also received special proclamations from the Commonwealth of Virginia, the City of Newport News, and the City of Hampton. Newport News Shipbuilding is recognizing the school's centennial anniversary throughout 2019 in many other ways, including video messages from people across Virginia congratulating the Apprentice School on the milestone. You can see them on the Newport News Shipbuilding website. And more history in the making, the USS George Washington, CVN 73's midlife refueling and complex overhaul continues at Newport News Shipbuilding. Things are moving forward, and that includes the flooding of the dry dock. And while the upgrades and modernization will bring the ship into the 21st century, the overhaul also includes a bit of history. Shipbuilders installed an anchor from the decommissioned Enterprise, CVN 65. The 32-ton anchor was refurbished and was installed in August, saving money and time. As CVN 79 takes shape in Dry Dock 12, the crew is setting up shop at Newport News Shipbuilding. The very first CVN 79 Kennedy crew members were on hand for a ribbon-cutting ceremony for their headquarters on West Avenue in Newport News. The ship's CO cut the ribbon on October 1st, welcoming the new crew and recognizing this important day in the life of CVN 79.
And I know we'll have a lot of hard work ahead of us, a lot of challenges, a lot of long days, but I'm confident with your skills, your talents, your dedication, that we will in fact be successful in building the best command in the United States Navy.
A big celebration in downtown Newport News as the new Brooks Crossing office complex is officially opened. Lena Wallace joins us now with more on the importance of this new facility.
Virtual reality, laser cutting, and check out these 3D printers. It's all new technology at the fingertips of people in the southeast community of Newport News, right in the backyard of Newport News Shipbuilding.
With a cut of the ribbon,
two, one.
Curious minds enter the Brooks Crossing Innovation and Opportunity Center for the first time. The new home to career development in science, technology, engineering, and math education establishes pipelines for workforce readiness.
What I think about this place is I honestly think it's a really good opportunity for young people to learn new skills that can help them in the future, find like good careers, good opportunities, and stuff like that.
It's very nice to see how much technology has grown and how much it can help us and how fun it can be.
Leaders from the city, Old Dominion University, and Newport News Shipbuilding all play a role in the community center located on the first floor. And on the upper floors, offices of shipbuilders who work in engineering and design. The proximity allows students to understand what careers might be available to them.
It's definitely going to be beneficial for the shipyard. I know we've been going through the digital transformation, so it definitely kind of merges with what we're doing at the shipyard along with what the community is trying to do.
And on the other side, the Brooks Crossing Opportunity Center, where you can participate in career readiness seminars, workshops, and training programs.
The center is the first of its kind in Virginia, meant to help the current workforce and help create the future one. For Focus NNS, I'm Lena Wallace. Back to you, Brian.
All right, thank you so much, Lena. In just a few months, the aircraft carrier Kennedy, CVN-79, will be christened and launched. It's the second aircraft carrier to bear the name of President Kennedy. Our Kelly Tatum has a look at the man, the museum, and the aircraft carrier.
Located on the banks of Dorchester Bay in Boston lies the John F. Kennedy Presidential Library and Museum, a dedication to life, leadership, and legacy of the 35th President of the United States. John Fitzgerald Kennedy, known as Jack by his family and friends, was the second of nine children. He had three brothers and five sisters and was raised in a very close-knit Irish Catholic family outside of Boston, Massachusetts.
It's a lot of family together time on Cape Cod, and a lot of summers with tag football and sailing and other endeavors that really enhanced his appreciation of not only family, but New England and natural beauty and the water.
Politics ran in the Kennedy family, but John initially didn't want a life of politics. He aspired to be a teacher and a writer. After graduating from Harvard, John joined the Navy and was made lieutenant and assigned to the South Pacific as commander of a patrol torpedo boat, the PT-109.
In a night patrol, not seeing it until it was too late, a naval destroyer bearing down on them crashed into PT-109, splitting it in half, sinking it, killing two crewmen. He and the surviving crew were able to swim some miles, perhaps 3 miles, to the nearest island, where they survived for 6 days before being discovered by some local Solomon Islanders, who suggested that he carve a message in a coconut husk, and one of the local islanders swam it out ultimately to an Australian ship, which relayed the message to the U.S. Navy, which then knew to look for them. And so that is how they ultimately survive.
Once home, John began considering politics. His father convinced him to run for Congress.
Well, President Kennedy very much believed in public service and really entered into politics believing that it was a noble profession. He admired the courage that was called upon in service of the nation in times of need in particular, and encouraged young people everywhere to consider a life of public service. And politics is certainly a way to do that.
So, my fellow Americans, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country.
John F. Kennedy was more than a president. He was a man of innovation. He understood the importance of space exploration, the humanity of civil rights, and the necessity to sustain the most powerful military in the world. And now, with the construction of CVN-79, one can only wonder what JFK would have thought about having the most technologically advanced aircraft carrier in the world named for him.
I'll speculate a little bit, though it's hard to know exactly what President Kennedy would think of such an incredibly significant achievement and honor. I think because he was so involved in advancing technology through the moonshot and the whole NASA space program, I think he would appreciate the scientific achievement involved in creating such a craft. I think he would just be amazed by it.
John F. Kennedy's legacy for courage, hope, and freedom lives on in CVN-79. For Focus NNS, I'm Kelly Tatum. Back to you, Brian.
All right, Kelly, thank you so much for that, and welcome to the Focus NNS team. Well, that's going to do it for this edition of Focus NNS from Boston, Massachusetts, and the John F. Kennedy Library and Museum. Remember, don't miss out on timely and important information. Download our free app, NNS To Go. It's available in the Google and Apple stores and on your smartphones and tablets. And don't forget to check out the latest news in our weekly publication, Currents. And remember, Focus NNS is available on numerous stations throughout the state of Virginia. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Brian Moore.